You're listening to the audio production of The Great Dechurching. Who's leaving? Why are they going? And what will it take to bring them back? By Jim Davis and Michael Graham with Ryan P. Burge. Published by Zondervan and read by Jim Davis and Michael Graham. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
Dedication to our church family at Orlando Grace Church.
Forward. We're living amid the largest and fastest transformation of religion in American history, what Jim Davis and Michael Graham describe as the Great Dechurching. Aided by Ryan Burge, this book deploys the best cutting-edge research on some 40 million Americans who have left church in the last 25 years. You'll find in this book the most comprehensive, detailed reasons that our family and friends and neighbors have left the church. But Davis and Graham don't leave the church leaders in despair. They show us the reasons these millions might return to church. They write with pastoral perspective on the kinds of churches that can thrive in our secular age. Best of all, they ground their counsel in biblical and theological reflection that has sustained God's people for thousands of years. We have no reason to fear, even if the church across the West continues to lose political and cultural power. After all, consider the context of the Bible itself. In Daniel chapter 1, verses 12 and 13, the titular brave young man knows he's playing with house money. Even though he's been torn away from his home and carried away in exile, Daniel acts like he knows the final score of the game before it's even played. You try your diet and we'll try ours. His tone is less defiant than confident. Why isn't he fazed? Because his heart belongs to God. No matter where he lives, he's not anxious. Babylon is only his temporary home. He'll serve there with distinction. But his heart belongs with God, who is the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, the Lord of Babylon and Jerusalem. By contrast, many American Christians today suffer from anxiety because they feel like they've lost their home. They may not have been taken away from their houses and land and churches, but they don't feel like their nation or city feels like home any longer. When we're anxious and afraid, we get angry, and no one wants an angry neighbor. Daniel, however, was a great neighbor. In Daniel chapter 1, verse 17, we see how he blesses Babylon and King Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel knew where he lived, Babylon. Where do we live? My home city, Birmingham, is Babylon. My home state, Alabama, is Babylon. The United States of America is Babylon. Three times in the New Testament, we see that exile is our status as believers in Christ until Jesus returns or calls us home. One of these passages is Hebrews chapter 11, verses 13 through 16, which urges Christians to follow the example of faith shown by the saints of the Old Testament. These all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, our God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. Daniel belongs in this hall of faith and these heroes of the Old Testament who anticipate the Savior to come. As God's son, Jesus Christ wasn't dragged kicking and screaming from his home at the Father's right hand. He came to Babylon willingly to rescue us. He endured exile so that all who repent of their sins and believe in him could go home. We might live in Babylon right now, but thanks to Christ, one day we'll live in New Jerusalem. We're in exile now, but soon we'll be home. Until then, the Great Dechurching will help you live by faith in Babylon. Colin Hansen, Executive Director of the Keller Center for Cultural Apologetics. Introduction. The spiritual landscape of our city, Orlando, Florida, has changed more than most could have imagined 30 years ago. In the 1990s and early 2000s, Orlando looked like it would be the new Christian Mecca. First Presbyterian Church was the second largest mainline church in the nation. First Baptist Church was booming, and their pastor was president of the Southern Baptist Convention. Northland Church, pastored by Joel Hunter, grew to more than 20,000 people. He served as spiritual advisor to the President of the United States and now serves on the board of the National Association of Evangelicals. His son Isaac planted a church downtown that drew thousands of millennials and even some NBA players, including Dwight Howard. Reformed Theological Seminary expanded to Orlando, and soon after, the largest parachurch missions agency in the world, Campus Crusade for Christ, relocated its headquarters here. R.C. Sproul and Ligonier, Wycliffe Pioneers, and about a dozen other Christian ministries followed suit. Every aspect of the theological spectrum seemed to be booming in Orlando, as Benny Hinn and Paula White also pastored churches here. Now, Orlando has the same percentage of evangelicals as New York City and Seattle, as 42%, roughly 2 million people, of our metropolitan area have stopped attending church. We call them the dechurched. What has happened here is happening all over the country. The national aspect of this phenomenon hit me when I was giving a brief talk at a donor event for a global ministry with attendees from all over the country. I spoke for about 10 minutes about dechurching and was followed by a nationally known pastor who gave a great, more general, gospel-centered keynote message. After the evening session was finished, people lined up to speak with me, ask me questions, and give me business cards, offering to help in any way with our work. In a somewhat surreal moment, I looked over to see the other speaker getting coffee by himself. I was confused at first, but the logic soon settled in. He was the better speaker with the bigger platform, but when it came to dechurching, I was talking about this audience's friends, children, and grandchildren. They had seen the people they love most depart from the institution they need most, the church. The dechurched aren't just numbers on a spreadsheet, they're people we know and love. What began as a desire to equip our local church through a podcast called As in Heaven became a research project that eventually developed into this book. Our desire to effectively reach the dechurched in Orlando and to help prevent more dechurching unexpectedly took on a national scope. We had anecdotal observations and experiences with the dechurched, but those could only get us so far. There wasn't much data available, and what was out there was older and wasn't going through academic review boards. We could find nothing recent that comprehensively explained why people are leaving, where they are going, and what we can do to bring them back. It isn't hard to see the spiritual landscape changing fast, but we desired something more than our street-level view. We needed reliable, science-driven data, and thanks to the generosity of like-minded people, we were able to raise significant funds to make this data possible. We engaged social scientists Dr. Ryan Burge and Dr. Paul Djupe to do an academic review board-approved nationwide quantitative study to answer our questions about the dechurching phenomenon. Dr. Ryan Burge is a political scientist at Eastern Illinois University, where he is also the graduate coordinator. His work focuses on the interaction of religion and political behavior, especially in the American context. In addition, he is the research director for Faith Counts, a nonprofit, non-denominational organization that promotes the social value of faith. He is the author of The Nuns, Where They Came From, Who They Are, and Where They Are Going, and 20 Myths About Religion and Politics in America. Dr. Paul Djupe is a political scientist at Denison University, directing the Data for Political Research minor and specializing in religion and politics, social networks, gender and politics, and political behavior. He is an affiliated scholar with the Public Religion Research Institute and the editor of the Religious Engagement in Democratic Politics series with Temple University Press. He has authored, co-authored, and edited 8 books that focus on religion and politics. When the results of our study came in, not only were our basic hunches confirmed, but the results were more shocking than we expected. The size, pace, and scope of dechurching in America is at such historic levels that there is no better phrase to describe this phenomenon than the Great Dechurching. 3 phases. The research conducted by Burge and Djupe was collected in 3 phases. In each stage, the research team contracted with research industry standards Qualtrics to find survey respondents and to ensure the academic reliability of each participant. For each of the 3 studies, the instrument was approved by the Institutional Review Board, IRB, at Denison University. The goal of the IRB process is to ensure that no harm will be done to those who participate in the research, and that their privacy and anonymity will be ensured by the research team. In all 3 cases, IRB approved the survey without issue. Phase 1. How big is the problem? For the purpose of our study, we defined a dechurched person as someone who used to go to church at least once per month, but now goes less than once per year. The first phase of the study was simple. We sought to prove or disprove this thesis. We are currently in the middle of the largest and fastest religious shift in the history of our country. This phase included a population size of 1,043 American adults. The data we collected overwhelmingly supported our thesis. Before now, the largest religious shift in church attendance in the U.S. occurred during the 25-year period after the Civil War. From 1870 to 1895, church attendance more than doubled as people resumed their post-war lives. That religious shift pales in comparison to what we're seeing today. Only instead of going back to church, people today are leaving church. About 15% of American adults living today, around 40 million people, have effectively stopped going to church. And most of this dechurching has happened in the last 25 years. Something important to note is that only phase one of this project was focused on collecting a general sample equivalent of the American population. In phases two and three, Qualtrics was given subsample quotas to meet in terms of dechurched Americans and dechurched evangelicals. This means that only the data collected in phase one can be used to estimate the rate of dechurching in the United States. Phase two, who is leaving and why? The aim of phase two of the study was to compare differences and similarities between churched and dechurched people from all religious traditions. It included a population size of 4,099 dechurched American adults. In phases two and three, the main goal of the data collection was to produce a data set meaningfully large enough for a machine learning algorithm to create profiles of different types of dechurched persons. Hence, all those who took part in these latter surveys were themselves dechurched. This means that in spite of the large sample size, when we write that a certain percentage of dechurched people in our sample fell into a specific profile or cluster, one cannot infer that the same percentage of all dechurched people in the United States would be in that same cluster. The goal of phases two and three was not to acquire a random sample of dechurched individuals, but merely to survey a large enough number of the dechurched to conduct this analysis in a statistically rigorous way. Phase two found that no theological tradition, age group, ethnicity, political affiliation, education level, geographic location, or income bracket escaped the dechurching in America. In this phase, we were able to create models for dechurched mainline Christians and dechurched Roman Catholic Christians. We learned that every possible category of people is leaving the church. Yes, some groups of people are leaving faster than others, and some are leaving earlier than others, but all groups and classes of people are experiencing dechurching at historic levels. Phase three, what is happening in evangelicalism? The third phase of our study focused specifically on those who had dechurched from evangelical churches. It included a population size of 2,043 dechurched American adults. As leaders in an evangelical church, we were especially interested in this group. Through the help of machine learning, a branch of artificial intelligence and computer science that uses algorithms to interpret large quantities of data, we were able to identify four distinct groups of dechurched evangelicals, each with very different animating concerns and each with different paths back. These groups are cultural Christians, dechurched mainstream evangelicals, ex-evangelicals, and dechurched Black, Indigenous, and people of color, BIPOC. This book is the compilation of our research and our practical pastoral applications to better understand and address the great dechurching. An important caveat, we are pastors, not scholars. Our hope is that this intersection between the academy, the research, and the church, our application of the research, will render reliable, helpful, and actionable results for many different expressions of the local church, and that scholars in many fields would build on this conversation with their unique skills and experience. Our findings confirm our grim assumptions about the state of church going in the U.S. today, yet they were also surprisingly hopeful in many ways. All is not lost. In fact, the American church's greatest work may well be ahead. Part 1. Meet the Dechurched. Chapter 1. What is at stake? In the United States, we are currently experiencing the largest and fastest religious shift in the history of our country, as tens of millions of formerly regular Christian worshipers nationwide have decided that they no longer desire to attend church at all. These are what we now call the dechurched. About 40 million adults in America today used to go to church but no longer do, which accounts for about 16% of our adult population. For the first time In the 8 decades that Gallup has tracked American religious membership, more adults in the United States do not attend church than attend church. This is not a gradual shift, it is a jolting one. Historical context. There have been roughly 3 periods of rapid growth in religious adherence in the United States. The First Great Awakening, 1730s to 1740s, the Second Great Awakening, 1790 to 1840, and the 4 decades following the Civil War, 1870 to 1906. From 1700 to 1776, religious adherence grew in the U.S. from 10% to 17%. Interestingly enough, and perhaps contrary to popular opinion, historians of American religion have long noted that the colonies did not exude universal piety. There was general agreement that in the colonial period, no more than 10 to 20% of the population actually belonged to a church. Fink and Stark estimate that national religious adherence rate to be 17% in 1776, with 3,228 congregations and an estimated 242,100 members. Rates of religious adherence rose significantly between 1776 and 1850, from 17% to 34%, primarily due to the Second Great Awakening that roughly spanned the 50-year period from 1790 to 1840. Despite this rapid growth, the fastest period of growth in religious adherence was the 25-year period after the Civil War. From 1870 to 1895, church attendance more than doubled from 13.5 million people to 32.7 million. As the general population grew from 38.6 million to 69.6 million, the net result was a 12% increase in churchgoers. Because this growth happened in the short span of only 25 years, it became the largest religious shift in the history of our country until now. What we have witnessed in the last 25 years is a religious shift about 1.25 times larger, but going in the opposite direction. In that time, about 40 million people have stopped attending church. More people have left the church in the last 25 years than all the new people who became Christians from the First Great Awakening, Second Great Awakening, and Billy Graham Crusades combined. Adding to the alarm is the fact that this phenomenon has rapidly increased since the mid-1990s. The 1990s is when church going in America really changed. As Ryan Burge writes, quote, "The early 1990s was an inflection point for American religion. Between the early 1970s and 1990s, the share of Americans who had no religious affiliation had only risen 2 points. But from that point forward, the nuns would grow by a percentage point or two nearly every year through the following 3 decades," end quote. Here, the term nuns refers to those with no religious affiliation. So what happened? While there's room for nuance on the acceleration of dechurching in the 1990s, 3 factors cannot be overlooked. First, during the Cold War, the terms American and Christian were often used synonymously in our struggle against a nation that posed an existential threat to America's way of life. President Ronald Reagan called the Soviet Union the evil empire. During this period, we added "In God We Trust" to our currency and "Under God" to our Pledge of Allegiance. When the Soviet Union collapsed and that struggle ended, it became more culturally acceptable to be both American and non-Christian. Second, there was fallout from an increasingly polarized religious right. Under the influence of Jerry Falwell's Moral Majority, Pat Robertson's challenge to the George Bush GOP, and Newt Gingrich's uncompromising takeover of the House, Americans in the middle associated Christianity exclusively with these movements and began to let go of it all. The formerly religious middle began to join the budding ranks of the nuns. Third, we cannot overstate the influence of the internet in driving the acceleration of dechurching in America. Even though the internet was slow and, according to the Census Bureau, only in 20% of American homes by 1997, students had access to the World Wide Web in schools. In 1994, the Internet Cafe was born, and the first internet connections in public libraries became available. For the first time, people could easily and regularly engage a wide range.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.